Hi there, good evening everybody. Welcome to the Purdey factory. Thank you for joining us this evening. My name is Tom Nichols, senior craftsman and transformation manager for James Purdey & Sons. New and exciting for us tonight. We are going to take you through the first of our stages of gunmaking, which is barrel making. Joseph Lawrence, our craftsman in the barrel shop, is going to show us the various techniques that we use to make our barrels from start to finish. So welcome, and I hope you enjoy what we're going to show you, and we'll crack on from here. So welcome to the Purdey factory floor. This is the craft floor, where all of the gun making happens within the business. It's a fairly linear process, starting, as you can see, Joe down the far end as we speak, filing up the barrels and working his way all the way down the shop over quite a prolonged period of time to the finishing shop where the guns are completed and finally test shot for delivery to the customer. So we'll head on down to see Joe now and see what he's up to. Joseph Lawrence, one of our barrel makers, 15 years experience within Purdey, and he's going to take us through the various parts of making a set of barrels. One thing to remember, what we're doing here is quite an abridged process. We are using various different types of barrels at various different times of production to demonstrate the process to you. So this will be a much longer process in reality to what you're going to see tonight. So over to Joe, who will start you off with the very beginnings of the tubes.
Hi, well, basically the very first thing we do is we literally pick up a file and start filing the tubes. And the reason we're filing them is to get the weight down, to get the shape right. And it's literally with a filing hand, and you're filing the tube, always trying to keep it round, always trying to keep an idea of what you're actually doing. And you move the tube round, and so on. Keep working. We use a file like this to begin with, or I do, not everyone does. And we also use strikers, which are essentially like metal blocks with file shapes on them. And these have all got subtle different shapes. So this one, you probably can't see it, but it's slightly curved. So you'll use that towards the breech end of the gun where the barrel is slightly curved. So again, it's exactly as I'm doing. And it's all about trying to get the shape exactly how we want it as you look down it, and trying to get the weight to exactly the specified weight for the customer. And that can take anywhere between 5 and 10, 15 hours per tube. That process, the filing process alone, will take that long. And obviously you've got to do two to make a gun. And once you've got them both filed to the weight and the shape you want, they'll be brazed together. The two tubes will braze together. So in this case, these are the two halves, and they will be brazed straight through there. That's the joint. And we're going to show you that in a minute, that process, or some of it anyway. And that is the very first step of what we do here.
So can you just say why we actually file the barrel tubes in the first place? So talking profile, all that kind of stuff, so shapes, etc.
The reason we file them in the first place is because the machine can't get that shape.
Yep.
We have to file it by hand. Machine can do a certain amount, but it can't get that perfect shape that we're looking for. And we are constantly looking down here to make sure there's no lumps and bumps. And the idea is that, because you know, when someone's shooting a gun, all they're doing is looking down all the time, and they will see that profile and what we're trying to get every little lump and bump out. Yep. So it's a very... Because again, a machine can do a certain amount, but it can't do what we can do.
No.
Basically, it can't get close.
Agree. Time-wise, days?
Days, you're looking at about that. This first process, you're looking at about a week.
Wow.
Probably. I mean, once we've brazed them together, they come back out again, and then they'll be then you paper them up with so you'd spend another 5 or 6 hours sanding them with sandpaper, various different types, and then getting the scratches out. But you've basically put scratches in by filing it.
Yeah.
I mean, that is the first stage, really. So we can show you the how we do the brazing and how it actually happens.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
We just had a question why we don't use a lathe, just seen that one come through. Absolutely fine to answer that question. In answer, we do use a lathe, no hiding that, but the imperfections that are put in and the profile that we require for the actual smoothness down the tube needs to be put in by hand by a craftsman. So a lathe can't replicate what this gentleman here can. So I hope that answers the question. Thanks, Joe. Should we head off and have a look at the brazing process?
Cool. You are going super modern braising oven. So, and if you can get a look in here, this is a pair of side by sides that are basically half sort of, you know, they're in the braising process as we speak. I'll take them out and we can have a look at them. So they've been wired together with flux. Silver solder, heated up to a specific temperature. This oven is very controllable, so we set it about 100 degrees higher than the braised melts because we want it to get there very quickly. We want it to get there quicker than it would otherwise. So, and you can control this very nicely. And we used to use a big gas oven with flames. We used to use coal, I think, probably at one point. We, in the modern era, with health and safety and everything else, this is a better option. It's the same process, it's just heat. It's not...
electricity rather than gas in a much more controlled environment. Yeah.
So, if you just... It's red hot, so we get... What we're looking for here, is very carefully look at the braze line down here, make sure it's nice and neat, nice and tidy. And then, what we've got to do straight away, is drop this into a pocket, powdered lime. And what that does, it allows the barrels to cool down really, really slowly. So in there, they will take about 15 hours to cool down. As opposed, if I left them out here, it would take about half an hour. And that, if you cool down that quickly, you essentially risk various problems. Certain bits of the metal could get hard, and this is a much safer and more sensible way to do it. And I can leave them there now overnight, forget about them, come back tomorrow and come up and start that.
Yeah, the slow cooling process is essential. Heat treatment, some people out there may know a lot about heat treatment and the types of steel that we use. If you quench them and cool them quickly, they will become very hard and very brittle. Obviously, at the end where the cartridges are going to be fired from, brittle hard steel is a really, really bad thing. So hence the really slow cooling process. Yes, it's a bin full of lime, but it's very, very, very effective. And a time-honoured tradition, but also a very effective procedure for us to cool it down. The barrels. So
cool. Yeah. Good. Excellent.
Yeah. So next
stage will be to imagine they came out, cleaned up, and then you'd have to start thinking about fitting the parts to the barrels, the ribs, fins, loop, that sort of stuff. I can show you kind of how we do that. We'll go back to my bench and I'll show you some of the things that we do to allow those things to fit. Yeah.
Here's one I made earlier.
I've got a 28 bore side by side. It's already had the loop fitted. So that loop's been hand fitted by me. And now we're going to look at how I can tell you how that's done by showing you how I fit the top rib. So this is the top rib. Long thin bit of metal. And it has to be completely airtight fitted. The entire length of the gun, so there should be in all of these, and there should be no gaps whatsoever. And that's quite difficult to do. First of all, the barrel's been handmade, and so the way we do this is we use a process called blacking. And what this does is you use a paraffin lamp, and you apply a very thin layer of soot to the piece you want to fit. And you'll see it, I'll just And this is basically like a micro thin layer of black dust that sticks to your piece. Let's sit there. And what we do is we sit it very gently on the barrels and just ease it backwards and forwards. And what we're looking for when we take it off, I can't guarantee you'll see that, but because it's not finished. What we're looking for is a thin line. So basically you're going to see the positive and negative, where it's touching and where it's not touching the barrels. And then I can see, so here there's a nice thin line there, so I know it's touching there. And then here it is, and here it's not a little bit. So I'm going to just blend these two areas in to eventually get a long, thin line all the way along, so I know that it's essentially airtight fitted. And that has to be that way for when you're going to tin these on. If they're not touching, the tinning process doesn't really work. They have to be very, very tightly fitted. So you'll see at the end here, the rim's fitted to the barrels there, and the same at this end. It'll be fitted at this end as well. And that applies to all the parts that we fit, the butt piece, the bottom rib, the loop, all those parts are fitted like that. It's quite laborious, it takes a long time. It is the only way to do it. How long, top rib, side by side? I mean, the whole process is another week, right?
Yeah, no, I totally agree.
The whole process is another week. You have to tin it on, and then you've got to clean it up, and every so often. And the thing with all these processes is that every time you do it, you've got to clean it up.
Yeah.
And clean everything up, get everything back to steel again.
Which we'll see in the tinning process in a minute. Yeah, I mean, looking at barrel making in general is a very messy job. It does involve a lot of stuff. I mean, you've got to look at Joe's hands and the process that we're actually doing. There's a lot of heat treat, there's a lot of grease, there's a lot of filing, there's a lot of everything. So it's, it is a very long job. I mean, it's something that's often overlooked as well. I mean, it really never should be.
What we'll do is I'm going to take you in the back again. We'll keep walking back and forwards, but that's because that room's there and we're here. But I'll show you how we, our tin lead on. It's basically just, it's soldering. Mm-hmm. But just a very fine version of soldering, so it's the same process. We use the same sort of stuff. We use pure tin, but again, it's not just like soldering wires together. It's a bit more to it than that. So I can show you what we do.
Yeah. Shall we go and take a look?
All right. Okay. What's happened here is the ribs have been fitted and then they've been wired. Wired with pegs to hold them in place exactly where I want them. The bottom rib and the top rib. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to heat them up and then I'm going to run hot tin using a flux into the barrels and into the ribs. And when it's all finished, the ribs will be essentially soldered on.
This is where you start to get an appreciation for the actual messiness and the amount of cleaning, as Joe was referring to earlier. So you see what he's doing here. This is actually all tin, all down here. We're looking to get perfect seal. So really, really, really essential part of the barrel making process is to get that perfect seal between the top rib, tubes, the bottom rib, the butt piece, everything that goes with it, because we do not want what we would call a leak. Now a leak is a small pinhole prick in this tin. If you get that, it can work in two ways. It can allow moisture in, but also when the barrels are hot, it can allow moisture to seep in, but also when the barrels are hot, it can also pull moisture in. What you don't want, and that's a really bad thing to happen, because the inside of the tubes will then have unseen moisture in there, which will then cause rust on the inside of the barrels, which you cannot see in any form of service. Unless the top rib is taken off, you'll never be able to see that. So this process is really critical.
You can see here now, just by the gravity and just by the heat, the tin is actually moving by itself down. It moves, it follows where I put the heat. It wants to go where it's hot. So as I move the torch this way, you can see the tin running down. I can actually show you more if I give you a bit more gravity. So we're just using gravity as much as possible and heat to allow the tin just to run down the barrels. And there, basically now you're going to see this tin line is being good. And I'll just keep working my way down these tubes, turning them over, back again, back again. The trick is not to get it too hot. You're trying to avoid getting it. If it gets too hot, you just have to stop, just let it cool down a little bit. But the idea really is to just keep it warm, not burn it. If you burn it, you know, it's just made, too well, it just makes more mess. You've got to clean up, so. And just work the tin down very, very gently. Always keep an eye on it. And if it doesn't look like it's moving, a bit more flux. There's actually pine resin that helps the tin move, and then just help it. Help it along. Give it a little nudge. Make sure that it keeps moving. As I said, it wants to go where it's hot, so that works with it. In the grand scheme of things, this is actually quite a quick process, this bit of it. It's the process to get to this point, it takes such a long time. The actual tinning process is the most important thing with this process is not to panic. Yeah. You don't need to rush it. You can just, if it gets too hot, you can relax for a minute, let it cool down a tiny bit, carry on. When you're learning this job the first time you do it, it's like, you're like, wow, there's so many things that there aren't that many things going on this street. If you've got it set up right in the first place, every time.
Right, so next off, we have that rather interesting thing you were talking about, is cleaning.
Cleaning?
Yeah,
we're cleaning that up, that's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, this we'd have to wait for it to cool down, and we would then give it a very rough clean with some paper, some coarse sandpaper, and then start trying to clean the excess tin off, because there'll be loads of excess tin here. There'll be points where the tin's thicker and thinner, and you need to clean it off very carefully without damaging the barrels or the rib. So it's a question of almost picking away at the bits of tin. But you can be using copper or a metal that's softer. The metal that's softer than the steel, but harder than the tin, so you can get it off. And that process is long and difficult, and it's a question of just doing it carefully and making sure. By the end of it, it looks really nice. It will. I mean, it's not. It looks horrible here, but given another day's work, it will be. Yeah. It'll be back to back to.
Lots of patience.
Lots of patience.
Lots of patience.
Cool. Right. So, back to the bench.
We're going to go to the tank first.
I don't mind. It's up to you. So, we've got another side by side.
Here's another one we made earlier.
12-bore side, yeah, we made earlier, exactly. That's had all the tin cleaned off it, as you can see.
Yeah.
And all these parts, you know, my gaffer told me that the idea was. It was supposed to look like one piece. That's what Mick said to me when I first started. Yeah. The aim is to make the barrels look like one piece, not like lots of bits glued together.
Yeah,
and this is where, you know, so that's what you're looking for. And that's the external stuff almost done in terms of barrel making. It will be polished at the end, but in terms of most of the work. So what we're looking at now is what's going on inside the tube, what's going on in here. And again, these need to be, this internal measurements are more important than anything else.
they literally govern what the gun is. The size inside tells you what caliber the gun is, essentially. And the way we do that here is using this machine, which is ancient technology to a certain extent, and I'll show you briefly. We're going to clamp the gun into this cradle. And the measurements for inside a 12 bore, the internal diameter has to be 728 thousandth of an inch all the way along. I hope I got that right. And the way we achieve that is by lapping it. And this is a steel rod with a piece of lead that's been cast on the end. And that's all it is, just lead. And then we use various different pastes. These are emery paste, right?
You call them carborundum, so right. Grit mixed with oil.
It's basically grit and oil mix. There's a few different grades. So we'll start off with quite a rough one because we're just trying to get some material out. And we paint the lead rod with the paste. Not too much on there. Right, let's hope this works.
Yeah.
Perfect. What we're going to do, that's going to start spinning. I'm going to put it inside the tubes and I'll show you how it works. And all I'm doing is gently allowing that lead to move up and down inside the tube. And the paste that I put on it can very slowly take off the inside. And all the time keeping it round. All the time keeping it perfectly round. So there isn't a better way to keep it perfectly round than this. And as I go, I can feel it and I can hear it, because I've been doing it for a long time, and that's kind of how I'm working. I can't see it, so I have to rely on what I can feel through my hands and what I can hear. If I can hear that sort of noise, that's telling me it's cutting.
It's quite accurate, it's given.
That's telling me that it's cutting. When that noise stops, then I have to stop and put some more paste on. Okay. Take it out. And I'll apply some more paste, carry on, and all the time, making sure that I'm aware of what's going on inside. So I need to be measuring, I need to be looking. Because we don't really have any choice but to be that size. If it goes over that size, essentially the gun is scrapped. And this is really quite important that we get that size exactly right. So we're constantly measuring, making sure where we are, and we know where we are. We're not anywhere near there yet, thankfully.
So the measurements here are driven by a group called CIP, who are a regulatory body, give us our sizes, which then reports up to the London Proof House. So all of our guns, and we'll see this as we go through the process later on as we move down into action fighting, all of our guns go through something called the London Proof House, which is exactly what it says. It's proof that the gun is safe to be used and continue in manufacture. That involves putting overloaded cartridges into the gun and actually test firing it to make sure under the most extreme circumstances it's going to survive and hold up to it. These bore sizes and everything that Joey's putting in here are critical to that. Everything is measured, everything has a maximum, everything has a minimum. Right, so we always go to the very, very nth degree to make sure we're at the minimum so these guns have an absolutely long life, effectively.
Essentially what we do, we keep using this process until we got to the right size, and we'd use finer and finer grit. So at the very end, essentially what we're doing is just polishing the inside of the barrels. The barrels will actually be a mirror finish on the inside when they're done. When the customer gets it, he'll look down there and it will be a mirror finish on the inside and the perfect size. And the reason we use this, partly because it is slow. It has to be slow, because if it was too quick, you run the risk of taking too much off. With this process, we know that each time we're taking so little off all the time. I've actually only got to take about 5 thousandths of an inch coffee inside of this, but it will take about 3 hours to do that. I mean, it could take longer, it just depends, but it will probably take about 3 hours to do that for each side of the gun. And the process is slow, but the finished product is amazing. You could, there's lots of other ways you could do it, but you won't get the finish that we get with this. There's mirror finish on the inside, you won't get it. And we've looked into other ways of doing it. We'd always have to end up using it anyway, at the end.
We've looked at Honings, we've looked at all kinds of things. Certain people, other manufacturers also use chrome, the internal of the bore, so they hone and they chrome. The finish we're actually achieving here, is better than chrome, as far as I'm concerned. The wear we get on our barrels, the way in which they operate, and the longevity of their life. We've only got to look at some of the stuff that we still have, that is still in daily operation, that's 200 years old, to know that this technique that we use today is still.
And this is the same technique they would have used, except for the same technique they used making cannons on ships 400 years ago. They did the same thing, just bigger.
Just bigger. Mm-hmm. So, it's nice.
And it's, by the way, it's called lapping. Sorry, I've been
lapping.
Yeah, we didn't go lapping. It's meant to be lapping. It's a lapping bench.
Once Joe's done with the lapping, or any of the barrel makers done with the lapping, and we're to finish bore size or to proof bore size, so we're ready and happy that it can go to proof, we have to perform one more test, and that is what we were going back to earlier with the tinning, so the leak test. We talked about leaks and how bad they are for corrosion, etc., and the life of the gun and cracking ribs and all that kind of stuff, which is obviously a really bad thing. So we perform one last test, which does happen again a couple more times, because even after Joe has finished here, barrels then move on through the rest of production, so they have a long life ahead of them moving through the factory. Now, whilst we look after them implicitly,
no, you don't.
Can't have a go at the finishes, that's not allowed. You can have a go at the finishes later. Whilst we look after them, they do go through other processes, but they do come back to the barrel shop at the very end. So, at the very end, they have a process done to them known as smoothing, which is removing any marks or any impressions and getting them down to the final weight of the gun. And they are also polished for engraving before they go to the engraving shop to be engraved with the maker's name and the border and everything that goes around them. And then they come back to Joe once again for the final finish, final polish before black. So they've got a long life ahead of them, they've got a long process. Bearing in mind that when they leave Joe, they might not come back to him for final polishing for 18 months or 2 years.
2 years, yeah.
So we always test them at the end of barrel making to know that they're moving on through the process in the sound and quality way we need them to do. And that's done at least another two times before they head off to black. So Joe will demonstrate.
This is actually the other half of that. It's the other half of that gun, it's the pair gun to that one there. This is very simple. We're just checking that there's no, where we're talking about the airtight fit with the rib, we're just checking there is no leaks. There's no air can get out, it's sealed. And the way we do that, this is a tank of hot water, so just below boiling temperature. Drop it in, not really drop it in, just gonna put it in carefully. And what we're looking for, or what we're not looking for, I should say, is bubbles. If there's any bubbles, if it starts bubbling up in any way, we know then there's a leak. And these ones are not bubbling. So they're all good. And that for us, that will be the end of the barrel making process. We will, for a long time. Mm. They will now go.
You said a question come in. The whole barrel process is not 2 years. It's depending on your spec. So your fine rosin scroll Purdey best bespoke gun, lead time from start to finish, from Joe picking up the tubes to the gun being delivered, is approximately 18 months. With any other embellishments, such as really fancy engraving and that kind of stuff, it will depend purely on what you're asking us to put on it, and we can do anything. So we'll see a bit more of that later on when we come back and we look at engraving and we look at finishing, we look at the various different areas we can customise the gun a little bit more. But barrel making, really, elapsed time is about a month, isn't it?
Yeah.
From start to finish. So
give or take
about 4 weeks from when Joe picks up the tubes to when we tank test them at this stage. So it's a long process. Thank you, Joe.
No worries.
Thank you very much. And please, obviously once we finish this, I haven't got a chance to answer too many questions tonight, but if you want to put some more questions in the comments underneath, we can look at them and get back to you with any relevant answers. So thank you very much for joining us. I hope you join us again for our next video, which will be action filing, which will put out a notification as to when that's going to happen. So thank you very much from a very warm London. Hope you all have a very pleasant evening, and see you again soon. Thank you. See you soon. Bye-bye.